Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews, a fan-requested review. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is Disney's Hercules Action Game, published by Disney Interactive Software in 1997. For the PlayStation and PC. Hercules is a 1997 animated picture that was done by Walt Disney Studios, and it's their 35th animated classic chronologically. Unlike a lot of the other Disney animated features of the past, this one wasn't based on a fairy tale or classic tale, but based on the hero of Greek mythology. The movie is noted for its unique animation style, gospel-style music, and a very twisted and distorted take on the mythology this is based on. It got mixed reviews from fans and critics due to those before-mentioned elements. Hercules was only a small success for Disney, making $99 million in North American markets, and slightly more than that worldwide. It had a few video games based off of it, released at the time of the movie's release, and the film itself was followed up with a television cartoon series that took place during the events of the movie. Along with the memorable songs and soundtrack done by Alan Menken, it's another classic in Disney's history of animated features. Providing the vocals for the main star and hero in training himself, Hercules, is Tate Donovan, who is known for his roles in Damages, The OC, and Hostages. As Hercules' satyr trainer, Philoctetes, is none other than the short but lovable actor Danny DeVito, who has been in various TV shows and countless movies like Twins, Batman Returns, and War of the Roses, just to name a few of them. The main villain of this adventure, Hades, is portrayed by James Woods, who seems to often be portraying the bad guys in movies, making him the ideal choice in this role. Rounding out the rest of the vocalists, we have Susan Egan as love interest Megara, Rip Torn as the God of Thunder Zeus, Paul Schaefer as Hermes, Bobcat Goldthwait as Pain, and Matt Frewer as Panic. The adventure starts out at Mount Olympus, where the gods are gathered around newborn baby Hercules, and everyone seems very excited about the new arrival. That is, all except for Hades, who is already plotting his own takeover of Mount Olympus. When Hades learns that the only thing that will ruin his plans to take over Mount Olympus have to do with Hercules himself, he of course tries to make sure that Hercules is never able to do so. He sends his minions, Pain and Panic, to take away the baby and make him mortal through the use of a potion. Pain and Panic kidnap young Hercules and make him drink almost all of the potion before they are scared away, unable to finish the job of eliminating him. Two farmers take in Hercules as their own adopted son, and that of course leads to all sorts of problems. As Hercules learns more about his true origins from his father, Zeus, he is told to start training with Philoctetes, who will teach him to be a real hero. Hercules, along with his flying horse, Pegasus, start to train with Phil to be a hero, and the big moment arrives when he has his first rescue mission, saving a damsel in distress. Now, anything and everything that Hades puts up against him is thwarted easily by Hercules, as he becomes famous and loved all around Greece. Of course, the plot gets deeper as we learn Meg's true motives, what Hades has in store for Hercules and the gods of Mount Olympus, and the lengths Hercules will go to prove himself as a true hero and find true love all the while. It's a fun story, full of adventure, humor, a very nice musical arrangement and artistic style to it that fans of all ages should enjoy. Definitely something that should make for a fun video game adventure. And that's the question. How good a game is this in comparison to the movie it's based around? That's what you're here for, to find out. You asked for it, you got it. Sit back, relax, and enjoy as we get on to the review. Released on both the PlayStation and PC, in what is an identical game on both, this game was on the market a week prior to the movie getting its theatrical release. Disney's Hercules Action Game is a single-player, side-scrolling, quasi-3D exploration, adventure action game that has various level types mixed into the adventure, with boss battle, base stages, and a flying stage also mixed in for good measure. The only character you'll be using at any time of the game is, of course, Hercules himself, as you venture through 10 various levels in total of differing layouts as you battle and explore throughout the areas that Hercules dealt with in the movie itself. Loading up the game will get you an interesting opening screen showing Hercules carrying in the main screen and tossing it into place. The muses from the film will dance as they wait for you to make a selection. If you don't make a selection, you'll get demo modes showing what the gameplay itself looks like, as well as some video moments taken right from the movie. All very well done, and a good way to get you into the feel and mode of the movie itself prior to playing it. Upon starting the game for the first time, you get a cutscene using actual footage from the movie, as will be the case of all cutscenes found within. Fast forward to the first level, which takes place years later, called your basic DID, Damsel in Distress. You start out in one of Phil's training courses, where you have to use your sword to hit targets on ropes that are swinging about. You can collect coins as well that are scattered throughout the stage. For hitting all the targets, you can rescue a fake damsel that will reward you another coin. Next part of the stage has you jumping on high cliffs as you collect items, where top of this area you will fight your first enemy in fake birds that you'll have to take down with your sword. Next moments have you jumping over water-filled pits with huge sharks jumping out of them. After that, it's punching out huge pillars that block your path. Then they mix in a bit of everything towards the end of the course, while throwing in another move you can perform in lifting up heavy objects to move about and use as needed. Then it's swinging from poles high above. Towards the end of the level, they throw in perspective-changing aspects that some stages will have, where you can actually walk in the back section of a stage using a path to now explore those areas. And after you deal with all this, you reach the end and are now ready to deal with anything and everything any of the stages similar to this one have to offer. As you touch the lightning bolt at the end of the stage, you are taken to a level complete screen where they show how many coins you got that were found on the stage, and how many of the Hercules letters were found is also displayed. Finding all of these letters will enable you to continue where you left off on a stage, rather than having to start the game all over again if you lose all your lives. Finding an extra guy pot will earn you an extra life. Find all four of the special password pots on the stage, you're given a password and save option, where you can save the game and use a password to return to the level at any time. Let's just say the whole method of what is piled on the stage end screen here is a little convoluted for my taste. I was very surprised that they didn't let you save a game after the end of every stage. You have to actually unlock and find hidden items just to be able to even save the game or get a password. All these coins really don't amount to anything either, which is another surprise, as it's almost impossible to get every single coin found on any given stage as it is. Well, after the stage ends, you move on to stage 2, Hero's Gauntlet, which is a different type of stage setup where instead of side-scrolling as the previous stage was, now you're automatically running vertically through it from the bottom upward and having to jump over and dodge all sorts of obstacles. And this stage again will teach you what to expect on all the stages similar to this one, but we'll focus more on what all stage variants have to offer, more specifically in a bit. The on-screen displays in this game are quite simplistic, as there are really only three displays that are on-screen for most of the game, and they are located on the top of the screen on the side-scrolling stages, and the bottom of the screen on the running upward stages. There's a circular icon on the left side of the screen, and it will rotate from showing a drawing of Hercules' head to displaying a number. And this is pretty much just your life counter. Extra lives are actually important in this game, as this isn't one of those games that you instantly start back where you left off at when you lose all your lives. When you lose all your lives on a level, you are given the defeat ending, and then a game over screen, and you're taken back to the start. This is where you have to hope you either got all the Hercules letters on a stage prior, or were able to get that hard to get save option or password, so you don't have to restart your game from the beginning. Otherwise, as will be the case with many of us playing here the first few times, it's back to the start of the game where you have to try it all over again. Thankfully, you can get extra lives by collecting the extra life jars that will show up on various levels. And also there are checkpoints in the form of the messenger god Hermes that you can activate by touching him. The display next to this is a long horizontal orange bar that is of course Hercules' life meter. With every hit Hercules takes, a part of it will disappear, turning the bar blue. Once it's fully blue, Hercules of course loses a life. There are items to help keep the life at optimum levels, one being Herculade. The drink cup as seen in the movie will restore life points to the meter. There are Hercules action figures as also seen in the movie, and these will extend the life bar, giving more possible energy that you can restore. They do balance things out well here with the amount of enemies and objects removing health, versus the amount of Herculade, extra life jugs, and action figure pickups being readily available on all these levels. The last display on the right side of the screen is a circular icon with dashes attached to it, and this is your weapon display. And you have four different weapons in the game that you can switch to, three of which you need to pick up the item representing it first to do so. Your default weapon is a sword, which you can use at any time and will be used to attack enemies quickly when your punches won't suffice. But when you need a little extra attack, you can get one of three other weapons to upgrade with. Besides the regular sword, you can get a lightning sword. This will fire out bolts of lightning in a straight line and take out lines of enemies instantly. Very useful and very powerful, and will help clear out waves of enemies with ease. And there's a fireball sword. This will fire huge fireball projectiles that pack quite a punch. Good for taking out large enemies that you want to keep your distance from. Lastly, there's a helmet that will give you invincibility while it's active. with the bars running out as it's being used. Very useful for when you want to slip past areas that you're having trouble with without worry of taking damage. So they kept it simple and to the point with the displays, and they worked well for what they were, with the look of the displays trying to match the style as seen in the movie, so that it all fits in together. I mentioned that you are fighting enemies before with all these weapons and situations in the game, but you can only really fight enemies on the side-scrolling based stages. The running forward stages are really just avoid and jump type of situations, and not fighting based ones. The enemies are kinda weird in that I think they really had to dig deep to try to figure out what type of enemies to have Hercules fighting against in this game. You have silly things such as fake destructible bird things that will show up throughout the game, and random thugs holding things such as daggers that offer no real threat, but take a few hits to deal with either way. In the forest, you have centaurs that block your path, as well as griffin-type creatures. When you get to the city, things get even weirder as you have to avoid some people as we're seeing in the movie, but this time they can take off energy if they hit you at certain times. Like the guy in the pillar talking about the end of the world, or a cat that speeds off leaving a trail of fire in its wake. And in the flying stages you deal with harpies all over the place as your main enemy annoyance. So like I said, there really aren't that many varieties of enemies in the game due to the way they did the varying levels and side-scrolling ones being the only ones where you actively fight your basic enemy. As we focus on the various level types, we'll see what this game has to offer for the most part, as it will go in cycles with each stage being one of the few differing stage types as mentioned prior. The platforming type stages are the typical side-scrolling situations where you can take your time to move through each of the stages from left to right as you collect items, deal with enemies, and sometimes take on a mini-boss who will show up in the middle of it. They add some other elements like being able to move to the back of areas of the stages where you have to find the right paths on each perspective of the stage to find the way through to the next part. These stage types will have the most variation to the other types, which are just straightforward and similar. They will throw in background elements that you have to worry about, like when centaurs are throwing rocks at you as you're trying to break obstacles in the way. Extra parts of the stage that you can explore to find hidden items and power-ups that are off the beaten track, and posts to swing from and jump to higher areas off of. So these type of stages will be what you would typically expect in a platformer this time period, having nice backgrounds and locations to set the mood, while keeping it traditional while you fight enemies, collect items, and work your way to the end, without worrying of time limits or restrictions. It's very straightforward, but also have their difficulties, in that you have to properly learn how to deal with each situation as they show up in these stages. Then we get to the second type of stage variation, and this is the constantly scrolling stages. They will mix things up a bit, but still keeps the same feel of the game, while not having you do the same objectives as before. In these constantly moving stages, you as Hercules will now have to avoid items and enemies, while also trying to jump onto platforms or to certain areas that approach quickly. The stages like this will keep moving you forward and get more difficult as they show up in progression, and they throw everything at you. In the training course, you have sharp blades and dummies and targets to avoid. In the Cyclops attack stage, you have to chase after a huge monster as the breeze are raining down, fleeing people who get in your way, and cracks forming in the street that you have to avoid. And in the voyage to Hades in the underworld, you have to avoid undead creatures, rocks falling from the ceiling, rocks rolling towards you, and venture on narrow passages and avoid instant death pits as well. These stages are definitely more difficult as they are fast-paced and full of just spam and requiring fast reflexes to navigate through them properly. Be prepared to lose a lot of lives here as you learn how to navigate and deal with these type of stages. They really mix it up when they add in the Pegasus stage, with Hercules flying on Pegasus during the Titan's attack on Mount Olympus. And this is a mix of side-scrolling and the constantly moving one, as that's exactly what it is. You auto-scroll from left to right as you have to fight all sorts of enemies who approach as you move through the various areas, all themed to one of the four elemental Titans, as seen in the movie. You take on rows of harpies that show up in straight line formation, all the while you have to avoid obstacles related to the element you are currently dealing with at the moment. The problem with this type of setup game is that it at times comes off as just a bunch of minigames rather than a full game. Each stage has its own flavor, not similar to the one prior in most cases, kind of comes off as purposely being done to make things difficult. So I do like all the variety found within, but I don't like the difficulty in finding letters and passwords in the game to make what can be at times a very challenging game all the more harder. But it does keep well to the story and situations by going chronologically in order through the story, even in these mixed up style of gameplay stages. Locations are all here and done very nicely, all looking as you expect and keeping to the style of the movie's animation. Very colorful and full of life where it should be, and dark and dreary where appropriate. Backgrounds look great as well, matching up into where each setting is supposed to take place. You can see focus and polish was put into these aspects, to really make it like you were in the world that the animated feature was taking us to. So you'll go from Phil's home with his training courses, then venturing through a forest en route to the Centaur River where he has to save Meg. Then it's off to the big city where Hercules tries to prove himself. Then it's a boss fight in Hydra's pit, and in a moment not played out in the movie, we have Medusa's lair in another boss fight. Back to the city for the Cyclops situation, the Pegasus flight to venture to Mount Olympus, and then the climax of the game takes us to the underworld where Hercules had to save Meg and take on Hades himself. So for the most part, they nailed the locations and settings quite well. Adding in some extra aspects, of course, you definitely feel like you are traveling through the movie along with Hercules as you play this. Vocals are hit and miss in the game. They do have the characters saying things, but it's really repeated one-liners or words that are used a bit too often. Whenever Hercules picks up the drink Herculade, he will actually say it.
Herculade!
While you're running through the training course, Phil uses the same lines again and again as reaction for you getting hit by obstacles.
You can get away with mistakes like those in the minor decathlons, but this is the big league!
Sure, I don't mind that they included vocals, but it suffers from early disc game syndrome, where it's a PS1 game that is still limited on how they go about it properly, and you get phrases being activated over and over again, and not enough variety in the phrases and use to make it fresh and enjoyable. Graphically, the game looks great. I really like the animation style they use in this game, as it matches so well to the unique style of the movie itself. It's very colorful, every character looks just right, and you definitely see the situations come to life. Whether it's taking on screen-filling bosses, or dealing with constantly moving stages that have various objects and situations coming at you fast, or even the simple side-scrolling stages which let you explore the areas as you like, it all looked just right. The video cutscenes that showed up before each stage took exact movie clip moments right from the movie and tied everything in perfectly to the stages to follow. Even the chapter title load screens use the art style of the movie. The whole game just looked great overall. Now to the controls, and they weren't too bad in this game. Each button does an action in the game, and it's easy enough to juggle through and deal with them. One button jumping, another using the sword, one doing a regular punch, and another doing a super uppercut. The D-pad moves Hercules in the direction pointed, and the L1 and L2 buttons cycle through Hercules' various power-ups. It's actually quite to the point, and once you realize what each button does, it flows nicely. The only real play control issues are the usual of the character not latching onto platforms or posts that you jump towards, and controls were also flaky many a times in the constantly moving scrolling stages, where you have to jump fast to get into platforms, and it didn't seem to always work for some reason as you crash against the bottoms of the platforms instead of jumping over them. Fighting situations worked well and were easy to manage and juggle through weapons. Even boss battles were smooth and managed well. So a few minor control issues, but nothing that was game-breaking at all. As mentioned many times, there are bosses, and there's also mini-bosses found in the game's various levels. Some of the levels are just boss battles, and a lot of the side-scrolling levels will have a mini-boss that will have to be defeated before you can continue exploring or move on to the next stage. Some of the mini-bosses are the Centaur, Nisus, where you have to jump on his back after avoiding his attacks, with you punching him out for good to finish him off. In the town, you take on a Minotaur blocking your way, and you have to throw huge blocks at him while avoiding his counterattacks. And in the flying stage, you have to take down a creature that you should use your fireball weapon with to take down properly, and we'll have to deal with it a few times in the stage as it shows up various times. But it's really the main boss moments that are the focus of the other situations in the game. Whole stages are devoted to just fighting these bosses as you take them on as only Hercules can, in one-on-one confrontations. Huger than life and filling up the screen, you have the Hydra and Medusa, who each show up back-to-back in the game, and the situations will come off very similarly. First boss, Hydra, is as expected, a dragon snake-like creature that will grow new heads every time you cut off one of them, leading to a multi-headed creature to deal with by the time you're near the end of this battle. You have to avoid its charging bites at you and cut off the head each time as you circle about constantly vying for position. The Medusa Gorgon situation is similar in that it's a huge enemy in the center of the screen doing attacks that you have to avoid and counterattack where applicable. She will fire laser-like projectiles from her eyes, as well as do a bounce that will send rocks crumbling down onto the screen. You have to avoid both and get her to hit her laser eyes at a wall that you're hiding behind, so that a mirror upon them will fall down and bounce the projectiles back at Medusa. You have to do this on every single pillar in the room until she is defeated. Both bosses are far from hard to take down, but are really nice looking. It adds a nice aspect to things and look really impressive as you're fighting them. It makes me wish they went to this well one or two times more, using monsters such as the Nemean Lion or the Boar, which Hercules is shown quickly defeating during the Zero to Hero song that played during the film. The game isn't too long, really. The challenge of the game is surviving long enough to get deeper into the game, and with how hard it is to get save options and continues from where you left off, that is where the true challenge lies. But if you're able to get through the entire game from start to finish, in what's about an hour to an hour and a half in total, you find a good adventure, for the most part, that stays true to the movie storyline. The last stage before the final fight takes us to the Passages of Eternal Torment, which of course is in the underworld, and it's the hardest of the auto-scrolling stages yet. You have to avoid rocks, obstacles, and creatures all trying to stop you from reaching Hades. Narrow passages that you have to jump to, and hard to make jumps that will suddenly show up. Thank goodness there are many checkpoints and health restoring moments during this, as otherwise this would be the end of the line easily. Once you are able to navigate through all this, it's onto the Vortex of Souls, where it's finally time to confront the god of the underworld himself, Hades. And this is another boss battle stage with platforms to jump on and fires burning about that you have to avoid. And you have to chase after Hades, who is flying about, trying to send blue flames raining down on our hero. Slice at him with your sword every time you are close enough to do so, and take energy off of his energy meter. Follow him wherever he goes and keep on slicing away. Hades will try and counterattack all the while in between each hit, sending his own fire blast in return. Every time you hit Hades, items will rain out of him, helping you to stay in the fight. Just keep following about, slicing at him whenever you can, and eventually he will go down in a short confrontation. You're rewarded to the final level complete end results, and the end credits of the game after that. But it shows one last cutscene, which is the ending moments of the film itself, showing Hercules becoming a god and saving the day. The game will end with the credit screen showing all the people who made the game. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the music. You earned it for beating this difficult yet not impossible game. That's it, alright. Well, I hope you like the song Zero to Hero, as it shows up everywhere and anywhere in this game. The opening game load moments have the full video of it from the movie. Each stage end moment has the instrumental of it playing. The end game credits has it too. So yes, they captured the music as far as that aspect goes. And some of the other music from the movie shows up as background music in some of the stages, which is also a nice touch. But I would have preferred if they highlighted on some of the other songs a bit more than just a subtle background fodder, while Zero to Hero got a lot more of the focus. I do enjoy Zero to Hero a lot from the movie, and it was a great choice. But most Disney-based movie games will have a few songs from the soundtrack to enjoy, and this game definitely could have used a bit more variety than the one-trick pony song they seem to highlight around all the way through. It's still a good choice for use of main songs to focus on, as it's one of my favorites from the movie, and sets the mood right while playing the game and finishing a stage to hear the song playing triumphantly. So for the most part, they did a great job of the music here, but a little more focus on some of the other iconic songs on the soundtrack would have given it that extra something to put it over the top. This game is actually a lot of fun, and just needed a few things fixed with it to make it a really great game. The challenge is a bit too high due to how hard they made it to continue or save your game after the game over moments showed up. Luckily, they do provide passwords to help you start off wherever you want, but even those are hard to come by in a lot of the stages. Also, I do wish the game didn't come off as unconnected and disjointed minigames showing up the points, with each stage being its own entity upon itself, and it doesn't seem to flow properly from stage to stage with how differing some of the moments come off as. And I would have liked some better play controls in the constantly scrolling stages as you're running vertically through them non-stop. But those are actually all minor details, and not really fault of the game. The game itself is presented very well, and looks like something right out of the movie. It's a lot of fun, and has a lot of nice aspects that any fan of this animated masterpiece will enjoy and want to play again. And when you take on a mini-boss or a main boss on a stage, you'll really see where this game excels. One-on-one confrontations really look like something out of the movie as you deal with a centaur, for instance, as the situations mimic how Hercules himself dealt with them in the movie. For a game that came out around the time of the movie's release, it does a good job of matching things up to the movie itself. All the vocals are there, even if some of the one-liners are repeated a bit too much for my taste. The cutscenes using footage of the movie itself is also a very nice touch to get things matching up to the moments prior to our taking part in them. Definitely one of the better Disney movie-based games. It has its faults and some things I would have definitely improved on, but given that they released this game before the movie was out, and how much it does get right, it's very forgivable, and these aspects can be overlooked and dealt with to still leave for a fun adventure from start to finish. I recommend it to anyone who likes a good nostalgic game and enjoys a nice short and fun adventure that takes place in a Disney-based world. Just realize it's a bit frustrating at times, and starting over again isn't fun. Be sure to check it out if you haven't already, and I give many thanks to all who suggested this game to be reviewed here, as it was an interesting one to say the least. That all said, I'm going to give this demigod-powered, lightning-charged, and underworld-escaping adventure the 0 to Hero score of... 's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a movie review.